Hey everyone, Sam from Professional Music Technology here. And today we're saying goodbye to 9-volt batteries as we're talking about how to choose the right power supply for your guitar pedal and how to safely power a pedal board. So before you connect the power supply to any pedal, there's three main factors that you've kind of got to understand and get right so you don't cause any damage to anything. Firstly, you need to know what voltage a pedal runs on. Secondly, how much current it needs. And thirdly, what polarity the pedal's power socket is. So the key words here are voltage, current, and polarity. And luckily, you can usually find all of this info written somewhere on both the pedal and the power supply, or worst case, in the pedal's manual or in the specs on a manufacturer's website. So let's look at voltage first. Now, most guitar effects pedals will run on 9 volt DC, and I'm not going to be going into too much depth here, but you've probably already heard of the terms AC and DC, and I'm not talking about the legendary rock band. Instead, I'm referring to the electrical terms alternating current and direct current. So that band name's actually probably not as cool as it sounded a few seconds ago. AC is what comes out of the wall socket, 240 volts here in the UK. And an AC adapter converts that to DC and uses a transformer to drop down the voltage so it's suitable for use of our pedals. Now, you will find certain bits of gear, such as larger multi-effects units, that do use an AC power supply. And because this tends to be a bit more specialist, a dedicated PSU will usually come supplied with the unit. But the key thing to remember is not to plug an AC power supply into a DC power input, or vice versa. But again, the type of power supply that's required should be clearly labelled somewhere on the pedal. So as I mentioned earlier, most single effects pedals run on 9 volt DC, but some analog pedals, especially certain compressors, overdrives and fuzzies, have been designed to run on higher or variable voltages, usually between 9 and 18 volts and sometimes even up to 24 volts. Running at a higher voltage increases the headroom in the circuitry of these type of pedals, increasing the dynamic range before clipping kicks in. So running, let's say, an overdrive at 15 volts will give you a different tone and feel than running it at 9 volts. That said, most manufacturers have designed their pedals to give their optimum performance at a specific voltage and will most likely have components inside that will be damaged if the correct voltage isn't used. Not enough volts, the pedal won't work correctly, and too many volts, you'll probably overload the circuit and blow some of the internal components. So unless a manufacturer specifically states that a pedal can run on variable voltages, always stick to a power supply that matches the correct voltage to what's written on your pedal. The next factor that we kind of need to understand is current, which is totally different from voltage, but equally as important when it comes to choosing a power supply. Now, every pedal needs a certain amount of electrical current to operate correctly, and this is measured in milliamps. This can drastically vary between different pedals. For example, analog overdrives and choruses will usually have a very low current draw, well under 50 milliamps, whereas digital pedals, such as delays and reverbs, will usually have a much higher milliamp requirement, with some larger units, such as Strymons and Eventides, needing up to 500 milliamps of current. So the golden rule to remember is that because the milliamp output of a power supply indicates the maximum amount of current that it can deliver, this must be higher than the current draw of your pedal, meaning that it'll be fine to run a 200 milliamp pedal from a 500 milliamp power supply, as the pedal will just draw the 200 milliamps that it needs. But these numbers can't be the other way around, as a 500 milliamp pedal will put too much strain on a 200 milliamp power supply, and it'll overheat and stop working pretty quickly. So for example, this old Boss PSA240 is a 9 volt power supply with a max current output of 200 milliamps. So it will easily power a 9 volt pedal with a current draw of 100 milliamps. But it would be unsuitable for something like a Strymon Big Sky, which requires a minimum of a 300 milliamp power supply. This also applies to chaining pedals together with a power supply daisy chain. For example, three pedals, each with a 100 milliamp current draw, adds up to 300 milliamps. So again, our Boss PSA240 would be unsuitable. If you are planning on running multiple pedals from a single power supply, you need to add up the total milliamp requirement of all of the pedals, and then to be on the safe side, double it, because as you put more load onto a power supply, the voltage can start to drop a little, resulting in pedals not operating and sounding quite how they should. And also, if you run a power supply too close to its maximum current output for too long a period, you will risk it possibly overheating and cutting out. So let's say you're powering 5 pedals, all drawing 100 milliamps, adding up to 500 milliamps or 0.5 amps. Ideally, you're going to want a power supply with a minimum current output of 1000 milliamps or 1 amp. So that's voltage and current. The final really important factor when it comes to power supplies and pedals is polarity. And this relates to the positive and negative terminals on the power input of your pedal. You can find out the polarity of your pedal's power input by looking for a symbol that looks like this. Most pedals will need a power supply with a center negative DC power connector, meaning that the center pin is the negative terminal of the connection. Some rarer pedals, however, will use a center positive connection, so you'll need either a center positive power supply, a power supply that allows you to reverse the polarity, or probably the simplest solution, a cheap adapter that reverses the polarity from center negative to positive. On that note, some pedals also don't use standard DC connectors and are instead powered through a mini jack style connection. If this is the case, again, it's not a huge deal as an adapter is pretty inexpensive and you can pick these kind of connectors up at your local PMT store. The important thing to remember though is to use the correct polarity power supply connector for your pedal, as if you don't, best case, the pedal just won't work. Worst case, you'll cause some pretty serious damage. So to recap voltage, current and polarity, make sure to always use the correct voltage that a manufacturer states that the pedal should run on. So for example, don't connect a 12 volt power supply to a 9 volt pedal. Make sure that a power supply's maximum current output isn't less than the total current draw of your pedal or pedals. And ideally, it should be at least double the total milliamp load that it's powering to avoid voltage drop or the power supply overheating. And finally, make sure to use the correct polarity power connector, which in most cases with effects pedals will be a center negative plug. Next, let's look at the different types of power supply that are available, starting with the most affordable option, the single AC adapter and a daisy chain cable. Now, these are a great option if you just need to power a single pedal, or by adding a cheap daisy chain connector, this one from Tortec costs about a fiver, you can power up to 5 pedals. We'd recommend that you don't use cheap universal power supplies, you know, the kind that you can pick up at a supermarket, as these are often multi-voltage and come supplied with loads of different plug adapters, so it can be all too easy to mix things up or accidentally change voltage settings, resulting in broken pedals. Instead, go for a decent quality power supply that's been specifically designed for 9 volt guitar pedals, something like the Boss PSA 230, which is much smaller than the old PSA 240 model and offers a higher maximum current output of 500 milliamps. The advantages of this kind of power supply is that, as I mentioned a moment ago, they're pretty low cost, they don't take up any pedal board space, and they're really simple to set up, so they're ideal if you're just starting out and only have a few pedals. The disadvantages though are that you're limited to the amount of pedals that you can power, both by the number of outputs on the daisy chain and also by the relatively low current output of this type of PSU. They're definitely no good for powering lots of digital pedals. Another disadvantage, and this is quite an important factor that I haven't mentioned yet, is that the outputs of a daisy chain are not isolated, meaning that they share a common earth, so ground loops can form between pedals, resulting in hums, buzzing and other unwanted noises. All this won't usually be a problem if you're just using the one pedal with a single power supply, but if you are using multiple pedals, especially digital effects, you're probably going to want to look at a dedicated multi-output power supply, which will offer more outputs and a higher maximum current. Now, these are larger, you'll usually want to mount them on the underside of your pedal board to hide them away, and they are a more expensive option, especially if you want isolated outputs to keep your signal clean. You can still get non-isolated multi-output power supplies, which tend to be a lot more affordable. For example, the MXR DC brick allows you to power loads of effects with outputs for 9 volt and 18 volt pedals. It has a total maximum current output of 2000 milliamps or 2 amps, and it costs less than £100. But as I mentioned a moment ago, you might risk problems with noise when compared to an isolated output power supply. So what is isolation and why is it so important? Well, put simply, with non-isolated power connections, all of your pedals will be sharing the same earth connection, which can actually transfer electrical noise produced by one pedal to another, which is why you get those strange buzzes, hums and noises that sound like electrical interference. And this will usually be worse when you're combining digital effects with higher gain drive pedals. A power supply with isolated outputs, however, is like having lots of little individual power supplies in one box, with each of those ground connections being isolated from each other, stopping any electrical interference between pedals. So obviously, although this is a more expensive option, if you are serious about keeping your signal chain as clean and pure as possible, we definitely recommend getting yourself an isolated multi-output power supply for your pedalboard. Also, because each of those outputs is like having a separate power supply, they each have their own individual maximum current output, so you tend to be able to run more high current effects from a single power supply. For example, the MXR ISO brick has 10 outputs ranging from 100 milliamps, fine for low current analog overdrives and modulation effects, up to 450 milliamps to accommodate thirstier digital delays and reverbs. Or if you use a lot of high current digital effects, something like the Strymon Zoomer has 9 outputs, each with a whopping 500 milliamps of current available. So what type of power supply is right for you? Honestly, if you've only got a few pedals that you need to power, and maybe you're only playing at home or in a garage band with your friends, a simple AC adapter and a daisy chain will probably do the job, as any extra noise might not be too much of an issue. And don't forget, there are some certain effects, such as wah pedals, that have such a low current draw that as long as you unplug the audio jacks when you're not using them, a 9-volt battery will last for absolutely ages. So batteries are still an option if you need to free up power supply outputs for more current hungry effects. But if you are looking to build a pedal board with lots of effects, including non-standard voltage pedals, and you want to keep that signal noise free, which is pretty essential for gigging and studio work, then you're definitely going to need a dedicated, isolated power supply. In which case, go and watch our best power supplies for pedal boards video, which I'll leave linked up in the description. So thanks for watching. I hope that's helped explain things a little. And if you are still unsure about picking a suitable power supply for your pedals, get down to one of our stores where our experts will be happy to give you more advice. If you need more info on how to set up a pedal board or for our beginner's guide to guitar effects, I'll leave some videos linked up in the description. And for our full range of pedal board power supplies, visit pmtonline.co.uk. As always, don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. That's PMT House of Rock. And if you enjoyed this video and found it helpful, please do give it a thumbs up, hit that subscribe button, ring the notifications bell, and I'll see you again soon.